Hey, it's Professor Dave. Let's talk about epoxides.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
Okay, so we know a little bit about the functional groups that are generated when oxygen is attached to hydrogens or alkyl. We know H2O is water, that's an oxygen attached to two hydrogens. If we replace one of those hydrogens with alkyl, we get an alcohol. And then if we replace the other hydrogen with another alkyl group, that's going to be ROR. These are two alkyl groups. We're going to get an ether. So we may or may not know a little bit about ethers, but at any rate, a cyclic three-membered ring that is an ether is called an epoxide. So the simplest form of an epoxide is oxycyclopropane. It's just literally just the three-membered ring with the oxygen as one of those members. And what we need to understand about an epoxide is that it is susceptible to nucleophilic attack in a way that we might not expect for simple carbon-oxygen bonds. So see, the thing is that we might look at this carbon-oxygen bond and go, yes, that's a polar bond, but it's not any more polar than your typical carbon and carbon-oxygen bond that you might see from a hydroxyl group. But the thing is that there's a lot of ring strain going on here. These are 60-degree angles, but these are sp3 carbons. So we know that sp3 carbons like to exhibit tetrahedral geometry. That's 109.5-degree bond angles. So we're taking 109.5-degree bond angles, and we're compressing that into 60-degree angles. So it's kind of like compressing a spring, right? It's really eager to release. And so that makes this irregularly susceptible to electrophilic attack. So here's some SN2 nucleophile. This is going to pop open like that. And so this is what we're going to get. It's an SN2 product. The only difference is that the leaving group, which is this oxygen, once it picks up a proton, is going to remain tethered to the molecule. So it's not a typical SN2 reaction. But so it's the ring strain that's driving this. Now, the other thing that we want to understand is that there is a high degree of regioselectivity in terms of which carbon a nucleophile is going to attack. And the reason for this is sterics. So let's say we have another SN2 nucleophile that wants to do something here. Now it's got a choice of which carbon it's going to attack. But the thing is, this has two methyl groups on it. This doesn't have any alkyl on it. So from a steric standpoint, it's a very easy choice. This is going to go all the way over here. It's going to attack on that carbon because it's much more sterically available. It's going to pop this epoxide open, and there we go. We've got our methoxy group that attacked, and then here's our two methyl groups, and then there's the hydroxyl. Once it picks up a proton, it'll turn into a hydroxyl group. And so, once again, it really is the ring strain that's driving these nucleophilic substitutions, and so this is one thing that epoxides will do. Okay, so we've seen what happens when an epoxide participates in a substitution reaction. Now let's look at what happens to an epoxide under acidic conditions. So here's our epoxide now. We know that this, just like any oxygen, just like a hydroxyl oxygen, can go ahead and protonate. And then what happens is that before we saw how a strong nucleophile was going to be able to do substitution on an epoxide. But once this is protonated, this behaves similarly to like a hydronium, right, or an OH2 plus on a linear molecule. And so this is going to be susceptible to attack from even just something like methanol. So this is going to go ahead and pop open, and then once after the fact, that'll deprotonate, and just, you know, solvent molecule will pick it up, and we're going to get our product right here. So once again, in acidic conditions, right, this can protonate, and then even something weak like methanol is going to go ahead and pop open that epoxide because, once again, the ring strain, as well as wanting to neutralize that oxyanion. Now here's the thing. We looked at the regioselectivity before, where a strong nucleophile was going to want to substitute at the less sterically hindering position. Now here's the thing. Let's say we're looking at acidic conditions here. So now we protonate again. Now you know how let's say to do like an SN1, we might protonate a hydroxyl, and then we've got a water leaving group. So the water's going to leave, it's going to leave a carbocation, right? So this is a little bit like that in the sense that once we protonate, this is going to be very happy to open up because a carbon atom can better accommodate a positive charge than an oxygen atom because a carbon is more electropositive. So it's going to want to get that positive charge. So this ring it's really ready to open up. And so that means that one of these two bonds is going to begin to weaken. It's going to begin to weaken a little bit. And so what that means is that Because this position is more substituted than this position, this bond is going to end up being much more likely to begin to weaken than this one. Because as this bond weakens, we begin to generate some partial positive character right there. And because this is a quaternary carbon, it's going to be very capable of sustaining that partial positivity because it is more substituted. So the thing is here, under acidic conditions, this is actually going to go against sterics and go to the more hindered side and pop it open that way. Once again, solvent will, after the fact, take that additional proton, and we're going to get this. So this is a regioselectivity that is different from the one that we saw. Because of these acidic conditions, we're going to see this bond weakening because this carbon is more able to sustain the partial positive charge than this one is. And that partial positivity, that electrostatic interaction, outweighs any of the steric influence. So that's what an epoxide will do under acidic conditions. So since we're talking about epoxides, we may as well talk a little bit about how they might form. And one strategy we have for generating epoxides involves reacting alkenes with certain peroxybenzoic acids like MCPBA. MCPBA is metachloroperoxybenzoic acid. So metachloro means from this group, there's a chloro in the meta position. So metachloro, and then peroxybenzoic acid. We know benzoic acid is a benzene ring and then a carboxylic acid. So that would be the carbonyl to the oxygen and then OH, but the peroxy, so like a hydrogen peroxide, we're talking about an oxygen-oxygen covalent bond. So peroxy is why we have the OOH. So that's a little bit different than a typical carboxylic acid. So alkene plus MCPBA, one of these oxygen atoms is getting transferred into that pi bond and we have an epoxide. So this is a synthetic strategy we have for generating epoxides to be used in synthesis. So let's really quickly look at the mechanism. Now, an oxygen-oxygen covalent bond is actually pretty weak, so it's susceptible to attack by this pi bond. Let's say this pi bond flips over like that, not literally, but let's just pretend it goes right here like this. Then we're going to get this oxygen-oxygen bond snapping over onto that carbonyl carbon. This pi bond is going to go ahead and grab that hydrogen, and then this bond will be the other bond forming the epoxide. So really, if we want to make sure we see which bonds are in the epoxide, it's going to be that one and that one. So these are the two bonds that have formed the carbon-oxygen bonds in the epoxide. And so this blue oxygen, which is the one that's further away in MCPBA, that's the one that ends up in the epoxide. So we've got these two bonds right here, and then the rest of this is a leaving group as a carboxylic acid. So we basically just snagged that one oxygen and shoved it into that pi bond. And so this is a synthetic strategy we have to generate epoxides. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.